Turnpike Sports is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com. Welcome to Turnpike Sports. I am Dave Weishaddle, and as always, I'm joined by my producer and co-host, Doug Weishaddle. Doug, it's getting a little scary out there with the coronavirus and what's happening in Italy and the restrictions being placed by the NHL and now the MLB with regard to media in the clubhouse. It's, I guess we've got to be careful out there.
Well, we are now doing the show without any fans sitting in the seats watching us. So,
yeah, well, there was never any fans for us, so it's sitting in the seat. So,
no, it is getting weird. All four of the leagues have now, I don't want to say banned, but have asked the media personnel to stay out of the locker rooms. They've issued memos that they
MLB and NHL did. I'm not sure what's going
on.
All
four have asked media people to stay out.
Oh, okay.
But
so it's beneficial now, right?
But the NBA has also issued the memo saying be prepared to play without fans in the stands.
Very strange. And with March Madness coming up, I'm curious to see how it's affected and how the tournament will proceed with what's going on.
Well, from what I'm seeing, a lot of the betting sites out there, they're lowering their over-unders. Because if there's no fans, or they're thinking of lowering the over-unders.
Is that the general feeling? If there are no fans, there's
no excitement, no adrenaline.
No really excitement or adrenaline, so bet the under. That's interesting. It should be very interesting how this tournament comes off.
The one thing that's going to be interesting, because a lot of times with the NFL, we're complaining about pumping in fan noises. Why don't these stadiums pump in the fan noise when they're not having anybody in the stands?
Well,
I mean, wouldn't that have the same effect?
It'll be pretty strange. Well, we got a great show coming up. The CEO of my favorite sports book, I get to talk to him, and it's great. Johnny Aitken, CEO of PointsBet. It's one of the it's one of the best sports books out there. And then we're going to have the book report where we talk about what's going on, the sports books across the country. So as I said, it was a busy week in sports. So let's take a trip down the turnpike. And today's trip down the turnpike is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with the side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. Now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using our promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com.
Exit 1.
Okay, first exit. As everyone knows, March is Problem Gambling Awareness Month.
Yes.
The American Gaming Association, in conjunction with the Problem Gaming Awareness Month programs that are all going on, has now launched a new responsible sports betting campaign. And they did this just ahead of March Madness on purpose. They want this
place. Yes.
And it is called the Have a Game Plan, Bet Responsibly campaign.
All right.
It's already live in two sports arenas, the T-Mobile Arena in Las Vegas, and the other one is the Capital One Arena in Washington, D.C., where sports betting's legal, but it hasn't launched yet.
Okay.
So, four main responsible sports betting principles in the campaign. Set a budget and keep it.
Smart.
bet socially with friends, family, and colleagues. They don't want somebody sitting in a darkened room alone betting.
Probably a good idea.
Yeah. Be informed and learn the details of the games, which I'm assuming that was almost like a no-brainer, but I guess there are a lot of people out there that just
throw money at a board, right? Okay.
And stick with using licensed and regulated sports betting operators.
Absolutely. I think that's the key. I think that's you're placing a smart bet in a safe place. So make sure they're licensed and make sure they're reputable.
Well, the big thing is getting the offshore books out of the licensed states, out of the United States overall.
And there's a good chance if you win, you won't get your money back with offshore accounts. So stick with the legal U.S. sports books. I think they're the best choice.
And in addition to the have a game plan bet responsibility campaign, the American Gaming Association also released a responsible marketing code for sports betting operators.
Okay.
Now, this is not for the gambling public. This is for the businesses.
Okay.
Four key areas: respecting the legal age for sports betting.
Sure.
Whether it's 18 or 21, I guess, depending on the state.
Yeah, some states have 18. What is it? New Hampshire has 18, you're allowed to place a bet.
Yeah, no.
Interesting.
That's going to be one of those state-by-state things. Supporting responsible gaming. That goes hand-in-hand with Responsible Gaming Month and also the campaign. Controlling digital media and websites. That's the advertising.
Okay.
You know, geared toward the legal age. You don't want underage gamblers trying all that stuff. And then the last one is monitoring code compliance, which is
making sure they listen. Well, absolutely. And geolocation, too. Make sure people aren't betting from outside the jurisdiction. I think that's a good move, too.
Oh, yeah. No, we'll see. The American Gaming Association is all in on all this stuff.
Oh, yeah. They're on the ball. They know what they're doing.
Exit 2.
All right. Exit 2 is our eSports exits, and we're going to be talking just briefly about the League of Legends Championship Series following the NFL's lead.
Okay. What did the NFL do that's leading League of Legends?
Well, as most eSports followers know, the League of Legends Championship Series just went through a restructuring. And what they're going to be doing is having their World Championships at the end of the year. That's the main restructuring. They split it up into two parts.
Okay.
Right now, the reason they're following the NFL is they are now launching Monday night broadcasts. You're going to have Monday night eSports.
That's pretty interesting. I like that.
You're going to have feature marquee matchups in prime time.
Okay.
Beginning at 8:30 p.m.
Okay. Now this is Eastern time, right?
This is all Eastern
time. Okay.
All
right.
It's basically wherever they're broadcast. Turner broadcasts some of this stuff online, and as well as on TV broadcast-wise, linear and digital. And you got Twitter, you got Twitch, all that stuff.
Yeah, I'm curious to find out where I can watch this. It'd be interesting to tune in. Monday Night Esports, interesting.
And they're also taking another page out of the NFL playbook. They're going to be having this show called The Academy Rush, which is basically the NFL Red Zone version of eSports.
So they're going to be flipping portions to each event, right?
They're not going to be doing it live.
Okay.
They're going to be flipping between different recaps.
All right, okay.
You know, it's going to be a whip-around show in terms of what's already been happening. And also, it's going to be shown over the weekends before some of the big matches, as well as after a lot of these matches. So it's going to be kind of interesting to watch how mainstream sports here, in terms of broadcasting techniques, are coming into play for esports.
Well, look, esports has been growing, and I think it's even going to grow more because we're hearing, I did an interview with a New Jersey assemblyman who proposed a bill for sports betting on esports. So I think with sports betting coming along in different states, esports is going to grow incredibly, I think. And with these broadcasts, I think they're going to get a whole new batch of fans. So it should be great to watch.
The one thing I like is these esports broadcasts are taking their cues from already existing sports-style broadcasting, which should actually allow the sport to become a mainstream sport.
Exit 3.
Speaking of expanding sports coverage,
okay,
ESPN plans to expand its softball coverage.
I got to tell you, I'm watching a lot of softball on ESPN. It's hard to imagine that they're going to expand it. Are they expanding it to their... I know they have a whole bunch of different channels. I guess they're going to expand it throughout that.
Well, ESPN Plus helped a lot.
Yeah.
But what
okay.
they plan on doing, they're going to be airing a record over 200 games
wow.
this season.
Wow. Okay.
Along with another 1,400 additional games on their digital networks.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. 2019, they had a massive explosion of softball on ESPN. They had the most watched Women's College World Series production since 2015 last year, mm-hmm. most viewed Super Regionals since 2008, and the best regular season on broadcast since 2016. They had 40% increase in viewership.
I got to tell you, they're really good games, and obviously people are liking it because ESPN wouldn't expand it if people didn't watch and like it, like myself. So I think it's a great expansion. I like this.
Well, you got to think about this. ESPN had the X Games for a while. Then they had all the other, like Cornhole and some of these. Well, what was
I saw Axe Throwing.
Axe Throwing.
Was that ESPN? Yep. I didn't even know that.
They always have Bassmasters on. That's always interesting.
But you know
to watch.
What? Softball is a game everyone plays. So, you know, you can relate to softball and you enjoy watching excellent athletes playing excellent games. So I think that's a great thing for ESPN to expand the coverage.
It'll be fun to watch the regular season in terms of seeing exactly how the championship teams are doing at the beginning versus the end. You know, sort of like what college basketball is.
Yeah, I like the fact that they're expanding the regular season because a lot of these televised ones in the past were the conference games, the playoffs or whatever you're called in I don't know if they do brackets.
They do
in
brackets.
Softball. Yeah, so we're seeing a lot of that. But, you know, I'm glad they're going to do the games during the season.
And, of course, you can't have increased coverage without creating a podcast nowadays.
Okay.
They're having the weekly podcast, 7 innings, to complement the road to the Women's College World Series.
And I'm assuming you can just go to ESPN.com and download it. I would think it's there.
It's going to be everywhere.
It's going to be everywhere.
Okay. Everywhere you see an ESPN logo, you'll probably see some kind of reference to women's softball.
Good.
Exit 4.
Okay, as everybody knows, the NFL collective bargaining agreement is being argued upon by everybody, players, owners.
I'm very curious how long it's going to take to get this ratified.
Well, they just extended the deadline for voting.
Okay.
Because, obviously, some of the higher-end players, the high-salary players, are complaining about it, and it's starting to affect some of the meat and potatoes guys.
The rank and file who make league minimum, I think this is a great thing for them. And you know,
which is 65% of the league.
Yeah, no, absolutely. When we see these football players, the recognizable football players, you got to realize they're the higher echelon. And, you know, there are other players involved not making as much money, not having as much security as these higher echelon guys. So I think the CBA is really good for the, like I said, the rank and file or the guys making league minimum, but maybe not for the guys.
The guys making
top
league
dollar.
Minimum are seeing a bump in pay.
Sure.
They're seeing
at
least $200,000 more in their pocket because of this.
Absolutely.
And while I agree that the high-end players, I guess, I keep calling them high-end, the high-salary players, the stars of the game.
Sure.
I understand where they're coming from because they want a bigger piece of the revenue. It's only... What is it, 1.5% more in overall revenue given to the player side?
You're almost – that 17th game, they're almost making less money than they are with the first 16 games. Check would be less than it is for the other 16. I guess that's the hang-up.
But again, that's the high-salary players.
I know. That's the hang-up for them.
Yeah. So. But the one thing that was interesting – when I was doing some show prep here for this collective bargaining discussion, there are now 36 mentions of gambling in the CBA. And also this player tracking sensor stuff, there's now 45 mentions in 456 pages.
Well, I guess gambling has become big money. Gambling has become a revenue source. The one thing I was surprised at is the sensors. First off, anyone who listens to me knows, You know, I don't get the sensor thing. You know, I think it's cool if you know how fast a puck is traveling, but you know what? I can't translate in that into a betting component for me. I just don't get it. Like the sensors on NFL, what do we hope to gain by this? I think it's good for the coaching staff if you know. You know, you have the combines year round almost. You know, you can these measurables are great, but you know, for gambling purposes, I don't know how to use them.
Well, if you look at now the broadcast too,
yeah,
I'm not talking about the gambling broadcast. I'm just talking about the regular broadcast. You ever see when they show the route tree of the receiver?
Sure.
And you see exactly where the receiver is going and the speed at which it is, mm-hmm. the angle the ball was thrown to him. All that stuff. You're seeing all that data being used not only just for gambling, but for some of the broadcasting as well. And I understand all that. But, again, the tracking sensor stuff is going to be used for gambling. I don't care what anyone says.
Well, I know it's going to be used for gambling. I just, me personally, I just can't wrap my head around how I could use that as gambling. For a gambling
purposes. It's going to be prop bets.
I guess. You
individual
know.
Player stats.
Don't get me wrong. I love the technology. I love the technology in golf when I'm watching it, when they hit the golf ball and you can actually see the track of the golf ball. But, you know.
Well, the reason I pointed out the mentions, the 36 mentions of gambling, the 45 times you mentioned the tracking sensor stuff. Oh, and by the way, for the sensor stuff, the new CBA pledges to establish a joint sensors committee.
All right.
NFL and NFLPA reps are going to be on it. They're going to be responsible for monitoring all use of that data.
Huh.
So you're going to see some, which is where the gambling comes in, too.
I guess. Because I know. It's
the gambling portions of the CBA, a lot of it determines upon revenue, sharing of the revenue.
Uh-huh.
It was interesting, some of the things here. The gambling references in terms of revenue could include gambling on the outcome of games or player performance. That's natural.
Yep.
Gambling-related sponsorship revenue, again, that's a natural inclusion.
NFL's making a lot of deals with
the teams
a lot
themselves,
of casinos.
Too. The individual teams too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, here are the things here. Gambling inside or within 200 feet of the outer walls of NFL stadiums. The betting lounges. Also outside the stadium.
Say that again. Wait.
The revenue will now is under this new CBA.
Okay.
Revenue, sports betting revenue will also include revenue from gambling inside or within 200 feet of the outer walls of NFL stadiums.
I got it.
So even if you're outside the parking lots.
Yeah, I know. It's
or the concourses outside, you know, going in and all that stuff. And also revenue from NFL or club licensed gambling apps.
You know,
that might be an interesting feature right there.
You know, that's telling me the NFL is almost accepting of the fact that there could be sports books inside arenas. That's just telling me that.
Well, the law in D.C. says sports books inside arenas.
Well, that's, I mean, it looks like they're almost saying, okay, we're probably going to have it.
Yeah.
Yep.
So. Well, the CBA.
Sure.
And also, the previous CBA from 11 years ago, the number of times gambling was mentioned, mm-hmm. take a guess.
What, it was 36 this time?
Yeah.
20?
Once.
All right. Okay.
And also the sensor technology mm-hmm. discussions, only 5 times.
I'm assuming that once was a restriction on gambling.
Yes. Okay. So it was a ban.
Yeah. I'm assuming that's what it was.
Yeah.
Well, today's trip down the Turnpike was brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store, available in over 95 cities across North America. Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using our promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com. Coming up, I have an interview with my favorite CEO of my favorite sports book, Johnny Aitken. And then we're going to have the Turnpike Sports Book Report, where we talk about what's going on in the sports books across the country. But Doug's going to tell you how to get involved with Turnpike Sports.
Well, to reach out to Turnpike Sports, you can call or text us at 609-512-5910. At Turnpike Sports are the social media handles on Facebook and Twitter. Our email address is info@turnpikesportsradio.com. You can also subscribe to the show audio-wise through Pandora Podcasts, iHeartMedia, iTunes. You can also listen to us on the radio.com digital app. And you can also watch us on your TV through your Roku, Apple Apple TV and Amazon Fire smart television apps. Just head on over to TurnpikeSportsRadio.com and just click on the Smart TV channel button we have on the website.
Stick around, because after the break, I talk to CEO of PointsBet, Johnny Aitken. So come on back to Turnpike Sports. Hey, this is Dave Weishuttle from Turnpike Sports with this week's Bet Flash. In Las Vegas, the MGM Sportsbooks will be rebranding themselves as BetMGM Sportsbooks. The change will occur at the sportsbooks at the Excalibur, New York, Luxor, Bellagio, Aria, Mirage, MGM Grand, and Mandalay Bay. Included in the rebranding are hundreds of new betting kiosks, which will be located throughout the properties. Michigan and Illinois have made sports betting news last week. Illinois went live with its Bet River Sportsbook, and Michigan has started accepting bets at MGM Grand Detroit, which is the state's first legal sportsbook. It is expected that both states will have mobile sports betting in the near future. And finally, in the 456-page collective bargaining agreement sent out by the NFL for a player's vote, 34 references to gambling were made. The proposed CBA also references gambling when talking about revenue and the possibility of players wearing trackers to monitor performance. It looks like the NFL is starting to really embrace gambling. From the seaside to the desert, from the betting lines to the sites online, Turnpike Sports has got you covered. And be sure to follow us on Twitter at Turnpike Sports. In a market already crowded by a number of online options, PointsBet simply stands out. And if you still haven't signed up with PointsBet, now is the perfect time. Hockey and basketball are in full swing, and baseball is just starting up. And hey, March Madness is right around the corner, so don't wait and sign up today. Awesome daily promos, odds boosters you won't find anywhere else, early payout promos. It's all at PointsBet.com, now live in New Jersey and Iowa. And don't forget to try your hand at points betting, where your potential winnings or losses from a bet aren't fixed, but variable right up until the end of the game. The more you're right, the more you win. And now PointsBet has a brand new offer for new customers. Just sign up using our promo code PIKE, and you'll receive 4 risk-free bets up to $1,000. This is the largest welcome offer in the sports betting marketplace, and we do encourage new players to take advantage. And make sure you use our promo code PIKE to get this special sign-up offer. PointsBet. Bets you won't believe, moments you'll never forget. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey or Iowa to place a bet. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. Terms and conditions apply.
Free stuff is awesome, but free stuff that will spice up your bedroom is even better. Just go to adamandeve.com and select almost any one item for 50% off, and then we'll load on the free stuff. Just enter this very exclusive code, BABE16, at checkout, and you'll get 10 tantalizing free gifts, including a sexy item for him, a special toy for her, ooh, and a third item you'll both enjoy.
Ooh.
And 6 extra special bonus items that are sure to rev your engine, pique your curiosity, and even blow you away. Plus,
free shipping!
Always sent in discreet packaging. Go to adamandeve.com now. Get 50% off plus the 10 free gifts when you enter the exclusive offer code BABE16. That's BABE16, because without it,
no free stuff.
That's BABE16 at adamandeve.com.
Welcome back to Turnpike Sports. Dave Weishuttle here. You know, sitting here in New Jersey, I have my pick of the sports books available to me in the state. But the one I use the most, and the one I think is by far the best one out there, is PointsBet. That's why I'm thrilled to talk to our next guest. He is the CEO of my favorite sports book. From PointsBet, we have Johnny Aitken on the phone. Johnny, thanks for joining us.
No, thanks for having me.
Johnny, like I said, here in New Jersey, we know how great a sports book PointsBet is. But for people across the country who live in states that have just legalized sports betting and maybe aren't quite familiar with all the sports books out there, can you tell us a little bit about PointsBet?
Yeah, PointsBet is a company that originated in Australia, but it's a company that's built on excellence around technology and the U.S. sports. A lot of people don't know here, but, you know, U.S. sports in Australia are the biggest sports. Probably 10 sort of years ago in sports betting, U.S. sports made up under 1% of handle. They now sort of contribute upwards of 30 to 40% of handle. And particularly NBA and NFL are extremely popular in Australia. So when we launched in Australia, we always had an eye on the States, and we launched by offering the most markets in the world for both for NHL, NFL, MLB, and NBA. So when that great day came, when PASA was repealed, we didn't, I guess, have to, you know, re-engineer our sort of business plan or our strengths. You know, we already had a great foundation built around excellence in US sports. And that's worked really well for us here in New Jersey to start with, and we're soon to be live in, you know, Indiana and Illinois to come. So we are a sports book that's built off great technology, great product. We do want to be different. We felt that the sports books that went before us in New Jersey, it was a little bit vanilla. So our aim internally is to, again, always be different and always be engaging. And that's been a great success, you know, story to date for us.
Tell us something about your background in the world of sports betting and how that led you to become the CEO of PointsBet.
Pretty much since I came out of the womb, I've been around betting. In Australia, horse racing is, you know, extremely popular and still probably makes up 70% of sort of revenues gained from sort of online sports betting. So I've always been around horse racing betting, but from a young age, I've loved, you know, sports, specifically NBA. I think on my 10th birthday, my dad got me a Patrick Ewing, you know, 33 Knicks jersey. So the fact that I'm sitting here now based in Denver with a team of upwards of 100 that work for PointsBet US, sort of managing US sports, and here at the starting line of the US sports betting industry is, you know, really exciting. As I said, the thing that separates PointsBet from the pack is that we have our own technology and we're very focused on being a technology company. We feel we're not just competing against, you know, the likes of FanDuel and DraftKings, but we're competing against Instagram and Facebook and, you know, our banking apps for time that people spend on their apps and how they, you know, choose to invest money. And that's why we sort of, again, hold ourselves to a really high sort of regard and our sort of benchmark in terms of the experience on the app. And we just released a new app about 3 or 4 sort of weeks ago. You know, it's the fastest in the market and we won't stop there. We'll keep sort of building things that are different and unique and sort of making sure that, you know, if everyone, you know, wants to place a sports bet, that they're doing that at PointsBet.
How has sports betting changed since you got into the business? I mean, I've talked to operators in Vegas and all over the world, and they tell me they've never seen the business quite like it is today. What have you seen as the biggest evolution in the sports betting business?
Yeah, I think it's changed sort of rapidly. When I first started in Australia, I worked for a sort of telephone business that had 50, you know, VIP clients. Clients that would bet a minimum of probably $10,000 a race or a sporting event up to 5 to 10 sort of million. That sort of game's changed now and everything's obviously online. And again, unless you're excellent in technology and the platform's stable and you're offering everything that everyone else does and more, again, you're not going to succeed. So, you know, we've made a huge focus of establishing ourselves here in the US. We felt we had a lot of learnings from the, you know, Australian market that, again, we could apply here, but we wanted to complement that with great sort of US talent. And we've done that both in New Jersey and now in Denver. And we're soon to, again, open an office in Illinois. So it is a vastly changing space. If you are complacent for a second, you'll get sort of, you know, sort of run over. So we always want to get better. We're always asking our clients what they want. We think even what works in New Jersey isn't sort of necessarily, again, going to be applicable to what will work for us in Illinois and states like, you know, again, sort of Colorado. So it's a very sort of busy time, but one we feel, again, with our own technology and that just pure focus on the US sports betting opportunity that, again, we're going to be extremely, extremely successful in.
You know, you've touched on it a little bit, my next question. I mean, PointsBet is very successful in Australia. When the US Supreme Court struck down the ban against sports betting in the US, did you feel that what made you successful in Australia could make you successful in the US? Or did you have a brand new strategy when you hit the U.S. market?
No, we always thought the sort of foundations of the business that were established in Australia were going to carry us a long way. The three being technology, excellence in U.S. sports, and being different, having points of difference. Sort of one example of that is points betting, which is completely unique to points bet. Very different from a normal bet where you simply sort of win or lose. With points betting, essentially, the more you're right, the more you win. We always felt that those foundations would carry us a long way. But again, to your point, we also know that, you know, the states and even each state of the US is very different and the types of people that are in each state are very different. So we really wanted to be hyper-focused and have a state-by-state strategy. We feel, for example, a market like New York, if it opened up, would be an extremely appealing market for points betting, given the amount of people that work in the financial markets there particularly, versus a state like Illinois, where, you know, sports like college sports, sort of NASCAR, for example, again, would be more popular. So we are taking a state-by-state approach built off the great foundations that have been established in Australia.
Was that one of the big challenges in the U.S. market, that every state really has a different idea of sports and betting, and you had to conquer those hurdles in each state? Is that the big challenge for PointsBet?
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. You know, creates a lot of work, because you can't just come here and have a national strategy and every state's open and you can just do big sort of ad spends at a national level. You really have to be, you know, hyper focused and think through each state. A great example of that is that for sort of New Jersey, the media landscape there is that New York supplies the north of Jersey, again, with above the line media, and sort of Philadelphia supplies South Jersey. So, you know, if you're buying expensive sort of TV spots in New York and Philadelphia, support your business in New Jersey, you've got a huge amount of spillage. It does create a lot of work, but again, the best people are sort of required to think through that, and that's what I'm confident that we have here at PointsBet. We place a huge emphasis on, you know, bringing in the best people. I know, again, that's often said by a lot of companies, but we really do emphasize that, and I've been really proud of the achievements to date from our group here in the States.
You know, you hit on it on the last answer, and you talked about what makes point betting unique. Talk to me more about the points betting, and what could that offer customers?
Yeah, points betting is a way, I think, to get more engaged in an event. For some people, as you know, it's not about being right. It's about being really, really right. So, for instance, you know, a client that wants to back the New York Knicks plus 10 and for some reason thinks that they're going to have a great game, sort of rather than have the opportunity to simply sort of double their bet via a normal fixed odds bet at the spread line, they have the opportunity with points betting to ride in the upside. So the more that the Knicks sort of cover the spread, if they, you know, lose by five, they've beaten the spread by five. If they win by five, they've beaten the spread by 15, they get a multiple of that with their stake. So a clear example of that would be the Lakers versus the Nuggets. The over-under for total points is set at 220. You know, again, as I said, a normal fixed odds bet, if it goes to 225, 230, if it goes to overtime and hits 250, if you've had a normal fixed odds bet, it doesn't matter. You've doubled your money, essentially. With points betting, you're sort of riding that upside. So if it goes to 230, you've beaten the spread by 10 and you'll win 10x your bet. If the greatest event of all time happens to you and it goes to double overtime and hits 260, you've beaten the spread by 40 and you win 40 times your bet. And the same is, you know, on the inverse. So we also allow our clients to define the risk that they do want to take, essentially a stop loss. So some people do sort of want to ride that max sort of, I guess, sort of velocity up and down, but others want to set a pretty clear 5x or 10x sort of gauge of losses or wins. What the points betting also allows us to do is to build the most markets in the world and extremely unique markets. It's actually funny, the first bet we ever took in New Jersey was a points betting bet, and it was on the time of first three-point shot being made in an NBA game between Atlanta and Indiana. The client had $20 a second on over 100 seconds for the first three-point shot being made in this game. And I still sort of remember it, sort of Trae Young sort of dribbling down the court and swishing a three at the 22nd mark. And the client, unfortunately, on that occasion lost, you know, 80 times his stake. So he lost 80 times 20, which is $1,600. I spoke to the client the next day. He's a well-known sort of professional bettor here in, you know, the US. And he was quite engaged by it all. You know, he felt that he'd become quite immune to normal sports betting, and it was all math and just trying to drive sort of earnings and revenue. But this bet had that, you know, added excitement, and he's gone on to place, you know, hundreds of points betting bets since. So, you know, points betting, has said, it's a different, you know, way to view an event, because every moment matters, you know, sort of, you know, what bucket's made or run not made sort of have an impact on your bet. So also when we speak to leagues and to broadcasters, they're extremely excited about this product, because it's a huge engagement tool to ensure that, you know, why people are staying in their seats or staying in their couches and sort of watching sporting events to the very end.
I have to tell you, I have your app on my phone, and I'm always on it, and I have it on my computer. And not only does it have up-to-date and accurate information, I think the information is laid out in such a way that it's very user-friendly. I mean, I've been on other sportsbook apps, and it's really difficult to navigate some of them, but yours is very easy to follow. How important was it to create a website or a mobile site that was user-friendly?
Yeah, I think it's absolutely number one. I think when you look at sort of customer surveys in Europe, Australia, and now in the US, whilst obviously promotions are important at times and great prices and sort of loyalty programs, ultimately it comes down to speed and ease of use. And I tend to agree a lot of the apps that went out before us in New Jersey were pretty much sort of replicas of Europe, which is a very different client base. It's a lot more mature and, you know, the front ends are very busy. And so for a client that's experienced sports betting for the first time or is, you know, more sort of new to the market, it's a lot to, you know, compute and confront. We sort of made it an emphasis to really, you know, simplify the front end, make it very clearly laid out, have a featured market section with the games that get the highest handle there, again, at the tip of, you know, our people's fingers. And as said, you know, last month we just released a new version of our app, which is probably a 3 to 4 times upgrade on our sort of previous app and is now probably sort of 2 times as fast as any other app in the market. And that's probably just the tip of the spear, to be honest. We're going to keep, you know, by finding ways to make the app faster and easier. We also released a function called Quick Parlay Builder, which is a first to market or first of its kind here in the US. And it allows clients really quickly within seconds to build a parlay bet and have a parlay. And again, it all just ties into speed and ease of use, which is number one for us.
You know, one of the other amazing things about PointsBet is how fast it's spreading across the United States, which I think is a testament of how good a sportsbook it is. Right now, how many states are you currently in or have market access to?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we're currently live in New Jersey and Iowa. In Iowa, we run both a retail operation at the Catfish Bend Casino in Burlington, Iowa, and we also run an online sportsbook there. We're soon to go live in Indiana. Touchwood, again, will be live there before the start of March Madness. That'll be online only. And then we have a further 9 states where we have agreed sort of market access. So I feel very confident that, you know, PointsBet will be able to enter states that we want to enter and choose to enter, and we'll have a national presence. And that's obviously extremely important as more states open up to be speaking in these big sort of national sort of media deals. You need, you know, simply to be live in the, you know, sort of states that matter, and sort of, you know, PointsBet's achieved that, and through our success we'll be, you know, awarded the right to enter, you know, other states that we haven't sort of captured yet.
Stick around, we'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports.
Sometimes life is wonderful and sometimes it's not. Cherish the good, but always be prepared for life's challenges. At Private Healthcare, we provide the peace of mind you deserve. With Private Healthcare, you'll get the coverage you want and healthcare you need. If your employer doesn't supply healthcare coverage and you don't qualify for Medicare or Medicaid, you need to give us a call right now. Private Healthcare is private health insurance for ages 65 and under with medical, dental, vision, and even prescription coverage. When life comes at you unexpectedly, you need to be ready. And health insurance is your financial safety net. If you're looking for health coverage at the best price and your annual household income is $35,000 or more, give us a call at 800-231-9279. That's 800-231-9279. 800-231-9279.
Welcome back to Turnpike Sports. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with the CEO of PointsBet, Johnny Aitken. You know, as I said, one of the great things about PointsBet is how accurate and up-to-date the information is, and that leads me to the deal that you made with the National Basketball Association. What does your partnership deal with the NBA entail?
We sort of made it a focus from sort of day one that we wanted to create a partnership with the league that was both a win-win, both for PointsBet and both for the NBA. It had to be more than just the official sort of data component, which is important to elevating the client experience. And so we've been able to come to an arrangement with them where we've delivered the first-to-market win probability metric. And what that means is it's a simplified way of, again, presenting odds. So we have a team of in-house statisticians, in-house traders that are based here in, you know, the United States, and they're obviously computing the probability of teams winning both at a pre-game level and then as soon as the game starts and ongoing. So sort of rather than present, I guess, odds in an American odds or a decimal odds or a fractional odds, this deal is a new way of sort of presenting odds as a percentage chance of a team sort of winning the game. And we'll see that win probability metric, you know, rolled out over NBA.com and other platforms. And I think it's really exciting. And again, we'll be really, you know, I'll be, you know, fascinated to see how it's sort of received and whether, you know, moving forward, that sort of percentages could actually be a way of, you know, displaying odds as opposed to the more old school way of displaying odds currently with the American odds minus 200 and plus 350, for example.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea, and I think that's really going to help out your customers to really analyze the game, what they're looking at. And I got to tell you, you know, we've had Seth Young and Darrell Rivas on the show, and it's amazing to hear how much PointsBet is doing to educate its customers on sports betting. I mean, you have something called the Darrell Rivas Betting Academy. I mean, with so many people who are new to sports betting, is that the philosophy of PointsBet, that a educated consumer is the best kind of customer?
I think we want to provide a service that both suits a person that's having their first ever legal sports bet and also a client that's an advanced bettor. I think for people that are, you know, interacting with sort of legal sports betting for the first time, we want to create a clear line of sort of distinguishment between an offshore site and a legal sports book. In an offshore site, I don't think you're going to find sort of many sort of betting academies or help on how what to bet. We really wanted to make that experience very sort of educational and sort of user-friendly in some respects, to really sort of dumb down what the money line means, the spread line means, how I guess to best explain points betting. I think we've done a great job of that. And then on the flip side, we do, again, want to target the more advanced better. And, you know, sort of our points bets led from the front by offering, for instance, the best odds on the NBA spread line. We're sort of, you know, minus 105 for every sort of pre-game spread line when the general market's sort of minus 110. Like I said, we offer the most markets in the world for the big four pro sort of US sports. So we do, again, want to serve both the sort of beginner better and also the advanced better.
You know, in keeping with the theme of helping out your customers, I have a lot of friends who bet on PointsBet, and they found out I was talking to you, and they wanted me to personally thank you for the Karma Committee, which I don't think any other sports book has. And for those who don't know, can you tell everyone what the Karma Committee is? And it's doing amazing things for your customers.
Yeah, the Karma Committee was a concept that I was very strong on as soon as I came to the US, and I was sort of riding the tech team to really get live as quickly as we could so no other sports book could jump on that opportunity. We were very fortunate that we went live pretty much in the mid part of January in 2019. And a week later, there was the famous Saints, you know, Rams game with that blown call. And it was a great time to launch the Karma Committee and a good Karma payout, you know, which we did. You know, I got calls that week off other sort of competitor CEOs sort of saying that I'm mad for doing this. And it's, again, we're going to create a really bad sort of precedent. But it's something that, you know, isn't a gimmick for us. It's, you know, at the core of what sort of PointsBet is. It's about, you know, what goodwill, having the backs of our clients. You know, we see a sort of relationship with our clients as being years and years, and we want them to have their wins and to have our support when there's a call that goes against them or an incident like Zion's shoe blowing out last year for Duke. We also sort of refunded the money on that. So it's been extremely successful for us. It's definitely been against the grain of what other sports books have done, but it's something that, again, you know, we'll continue to do over the coming years and in every state that we launch in.
You know, you have the Karma Committee. You give out early payouts on some of the bets. You offer the most bet types on all of the U.S. sports. Is that the challenge in running a modern-day sports book, staying ahead of the competition and innovating to the point where you're offering your customers something they can't get anywhere else. Is that the big challenge nowadays?
Spot on, that's it. I think, you know, whilst we felt the product or app that we went live in with New Jersey was sort of market leading or, you know, equal to market leading, for us, it was just the tip of the spear, and we've since made constant sort of iterations and sort of upgrades to the app. But around sort of promotions and price, you know, that's it. You know, we also, you know, we always want to be the sort of cutting edge of the types of, our promotions that we're doing. We launched a promotion for the March Madness tournament last year called Make It Rain, where every 3-point shot that your team makes, you get $3 in bonus. Wow. We also want to test a lot of these promotions and know what sort of resonates with clients and what doesn't. And that helps us to shape our sort of strategy ahead when we go into states such as Indiana and Illinois. So there's been a lot of learnings captured. You know, we've done promotions that have really clicked. We've done others that haven't. But it's really going to help us shape the future and our sort of strategy ahead.
You know, you mentioned your deal with the NBA, and as a person who was living in New Jersey and who saw the local news and the newspaper and the TVs when we were going through that 8-year court battle, I know the leagues were, you know, saying how terrible sports betting is and you shouldn't be done, but now they're making their deals themselves. I mean, you deal with a lot of the leagues now. What is their attitude towards sports betting? Is it they're all in on it now, or are they still hesitating a little bit? What has changed dealing with the leagues, the professional sports leagues?
I think there's two sort of main things. I think firstly, each league's at a different stage of how it's approaching sports betting. The NBA were probably the first out of the gate and had a very clearly defined path forward and how they want to engage with different operators. You know, and the other leagues are sort of following. I would say that we've had very great conversations with all the big four pro sort of US sports leagues, and we're actively working towards, again, like we have with the NBA, you know, finding a deal that works for both parties. The narrative, though, that we do share with the leagues is that, unlike, you know, offshore, you know, operators, you know, we have to pay sort of taxes, you know, what taxes at a state level, a federal level. We have to pay sort of payment gateway fees, costs around sort of geofencing, so we ensure that every bet that we strike is, again, within the state border. So adding more, I guess, onerous fees on top of that by our leagues sort of handicaps us when we want to offer great prices and great promotions and win back money from the offshore market. You know, I think that sort of narrative has been understood by the leagues, and they're sort of working, again, sort of with us to find deals, like I said, that are both sort of win-win. And ultimately, sort of both parties get the best outcome. And that's something that we're actively pushing, and it's something that should be front of mind for everyone, again, when they're assessing this sort of US sports betting opportunity, that there is an active active offshore market. And again, sort of none of those operators are paying any taxes, and they're offering the best prices and the best promotions. So it's a real challenge for us sort of legal operators to sort of match them, but it's something that we have to do to get that money back onshore and taxed accordingly.
You know, I know the NCAA March Madness tournament is coming up, and for some, that's the greatest betting sporting event of the year. At PointsBet, is that one of your biggest times of the year? And what does PointsBet have in store for people who want to bet with PointsBet?
Yeah, March Madness is equal number one, you know, number one for us. You know, along with the Super Bowl, it's definitely the event where you get the most acquisition, the most activity on the site. The sheer amount of bets that you'll sort of process in a day will be in the tens of thousands up to a sort of 100,000. So it's a huge time. It's something that we planned for well in advance. We obviously had a very successful March Madness when we launched last year in New Jersey. It was centered on the sort of Make It Rain promotion. You know, we don't like to be too stale here at PointsBet, so we feel we've got something more exciting up our sleeves. I can't sort of, share that yet, but it's something that, again, will come out in the coming weeks. But, yeah, it's something that the whole sort of company, again, sort of gets around, and we expect huge sort of volumes. And, again, it's, you know, I guess sort of really exciting because it'll be the first time that we're not only live in New Jersey, but, again, we'll be live in Indiana. And, again, as you know, Indiana's a mad sort of college sports state, and yeah, They'll have teams in the March Madness tournament. So, yeah, it's very exciting. Can't wait for next month for it to kick off.
Incredible things happened in 2019 with PointsBet. What can we expect in 2020 with regards to PointsBet?
I think the main three things is scale. You know, you are see the PointsBet brand now in states like Indiana, Illinois, Colorado, to support New Jersey and Iowa. You're going to see the PointsBet brand on TV, as I said, today to New Jersey because of the fractured sort of, you know, a landscape there. We haven't invested in sort of TV ads, but, you know, we will as we enter states like Indiana and Illinois. And lastly, what you'll see is just more sort of cutting edge technology and product. You know, we want to have the best client experience possible. We do want to, again, maintain that strength around sort of goodwill. So you'll see continued sort of, you know, karma payouts, great pricing, great promotions. But for us, the long-term game is that the best product wins. And that's what, again, with our own technology and the best people, again, we can build. And so that's the focus for us.
Johnny, we're running out of time, but can you give out a website or a social media address so people around the country can go and learn about PointsBet and keep up to date with all the promotions you're giving out?
Yeah, I think it's very easy. Just go into Twitter or Facebook. We have an active sort of social media team that work around the clock. These guys seem to not sleep. So they're always posting stuff and we've built a great engagement. Yeah, so search for PointsBet USA on Twitter and Facebook to follow us. And it's been great being on the show. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you. Johnny Aitken, CEO of PointsBet. Thanks for coming on and telling us all about the great things happening at PointsBet and for running an absolutely great sports book. Stick around. We'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports.
Tax Solutions Now is a complimentary referral service that connects callers to companies that provide tax services.
Money matters. If you owe thousands in back taxes to the IRS, how much can Tax Solutions Now save you?
I paid less than I owe.
That's right. Money matters. So call Tax Solutions Now and get the IRS off your back. Since 2014, Tax Solutions Now has been a leader in the tax resolution industry. Remove wage garnishments, property liens, fines, and penalties. Qualify for the Fresh Start program or even uncollectible status. How much can Tax Solutions Now save you?
I owed the IRS over $10,000. I paid a fraction of what I owed.
Call now to reduce or even eliminate your back taxes.
I called Tax Solutions Now and got the IRS off my back. Thanks. You saved us a ton of money.
Money matters. How much can Tax Solutions Now save you? Call now and find out.
Call 800-683-7377. 800-683-7377. 800-683-7377.
The Turnpike Sports Book Report.
And the Turnpike Sports Book Report is brought to you by BorgataSports.com. Your favorite casino is now your favorite sports book, available anywhere in New Jersey. BorgataSports.com. Sign up at BorgataSports.com using our promo code PIKE, that's P-I-K-E, and you get a risk-free bet up to $300 and 20 bonus dollars at BorgataCasino.com. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
All right, for this week's Turnpike Sports Book Report, we've got a lot of book movement.
Has it been busier than usual, and is it because of March Madness? Is that what I'm thinking?
I would assume.
Was one of those benchmarks for sports betting
that,
coming up?
That is one of the biggest sports benchmarks for sports betting.
I guess
betting.
Everyone was rushing to get out.
Well, here's what we had so far. Indiana, I'll start there. PointsBet, Johnny Aitken's company.
Absolutely.
Went live last week. Then their first bet taken was $200 on the Colts to win the Super Bowl.
Boy, that's got to be a big payoff.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, but
I hope it comes through.
But again, if you just finished listening to the PointsBet interview, we taped that before Indiana was launched for PointsBet. So, sorry we didn't have that in the interview, but we have it now. That came out after the interview. Now, with regards to March Madness, these two states were rushing and rushing to get this launched, and there's even a third state that is talking about launching in time for March Madness. I don't know if they're actually going to be able to do it, but right now, Illinois, Rivers Casino in DePlain, Illinois, was the first one to launch. They launched on Monday.
By the way, I got to apologize to Illinois last week. I said, they're not going to get it done. And they got it done. Good for them.
They got it done.
Good for them.
They are now the 15th state with legal sports betting.
Great.
Rivers was the first one to take a sports bet, and that first bet was by Eddie Olczyk. who put $100 on the White Sox. 16-1 odds to win the World Series. The payout, $1,700.
Nice.
That's a nice little payout.
Yeah, good luck, Eddie.
And
I got to tell you, you know, I was waiting for the Chicago market to get involved in sports betting. It'll be very interesting to see Illinois and especially Chicago and the great cities of Illinois to get involved in sports, just to see the revenue that increases.
What's interesting to me is I think Illinois is the biggest threat to both Nevada and New Jersey.
I would guess so.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Let me tell you something. Until New York jumps into mobile sports betting, you know, and if there's a sports book in the metropolitan New York area, then, you know, Chicago is probably the biggest market to get sports betting.
Well, what's interesting in terms of Illinois, there's no timetable for online sports betting. No one at this time has submitted an online application.
Oh, boy.
But I think you're going to see...
I can't wait for that. That's a game changer.
It's always going to be Nevada, New Jersey, and until Illinois gets mobile sports betting, you're not going to see Illinois have too much of an effect. I think they're going to have a great effect in terms of the other states. They may be always third, maybe more so than Pennsylvania.
Yep.
But the fact they don't have online betting just yet, you know, that may be a key to them not being one of the top operators just yet in the United States. Also, we had the 15th launch. We also had the 16th state launch this week, Michigan. Michigan will began Wednesday at 1 p.m. at two of Detroit's commercial casinos, MGM Resorts, MGM Grand Detroit. That is going to be accepting bets immediately on site. And then Penn National's Greektown are also going to be launching.
Great. Can't wait.
Now, Penn National is going to be using the Barstool Sportsbook.
Oh, okay. So that'd be great.
And Motor City, which is the third commercial casino, is partnered with FanDuel.
Boy, what a big weekend for Michigan.
Yep.
Should be fun.
And, again, you know, they also have another 23 casinos.
Michigan, really?
Michigan.
Oh, my God.
They're all tribal.
Okay.
Now, remember, William Hill has the deal with the Leilani Sands and the Turtle Creek.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I believe there's an... I think it was DraftKings got another deal with one of the other Michigan tribes. I'm trying to remember which one it is. I don't have it in my notes. I apologize for that. But there are two major companies. William Hill is a big one. And there's 23 tribal casinos that are going to be all able to offer sports betting.
Wow.
And it'll be fun to watch this. I think, you know, you got FoxBet, PointsBet, William Hill. We got the Score coming down the road here. You know, a lot of them already applied. You know, we'll see exactly what the tribal deals are. It was PointsBet that had the other tribal deal in Michigan. Right. So Michigan's already got market access. William Hill's got market access. We'll see exactly where that goes. In Nevada, BetMGM finally launched.
Okay.
They're going to be rebranding all the MGM sports books. You're going to have Bellagio, Aria, MGM Grand, Mandalay Bay, The Mirage, Park MGM, New York, New York, Luxor, and Excalibur are all going to be changing their sports books to the BetMGM branded sports book.
Okay. All right.
And
I guess a lot of new signs coming in.
You're going to see a lot of new signs. You're also going to see a lot of new kiosks. They're going to be installing over 100 gaming kiosks in all these properties.
I got to tell you, I first used a kiosk at Parks just recently, and I really like them. You know, I was a little nervous because I'm not
you like the kiosk or the brand of kiosk?
I like kiosks.
Because Parks is Camby.
Well, I like kiosk.
You like the idea of the kiosk.
I like the fact that, you know, they're located all over the property and I can place a bet wherever I am. But, you know, I'm not mechanically inclined, if that's the correct way to put it. So I was a little nervous about not doing anything without an app or, you know, being live at the window. But, you know, it was very easy. So don't be afraid to try a kiosk. I was afraid and I burst through. I conquered my fear and I actually like the kiosks.
Well, the one thing is that everyone is jumping all over with BetMGM. It's technically Yahoo's going around saying it's the Yahoo Sportsbook powered by BetMGM.
Not, Okay.
It's a branding thing. I understand it. Right, and it's, you know, Yahoo does not have a sports book. It's BetMGM. But you have access to the BetMGM app through the Yahoo Sports app, and I understand that.
Oh, okay.
That's all the sports marketing stuff, and it's the fantasy audience that loves that kind of stuff because you're watching and getting the stats. West Virginia, mobile betting is growing in West Virginia. I just want to hit this one really quick. 72% of the total handle of the prior 2 weeks betting, because West Virginia releases it every week.
Sure.
72% of that total handle is mobile now.
That's great. That's great.
52%.
It's good that it's back up and running because, you know, it's sad that it went down or went quiet or went
whatever. Well, the reason why I mentioned it in this area is because 52% of the overall handle of the state went to the Greenbrier, which is partnered with FanDuel and BetMGM, which is one of their other live locations.
Now, is that the I might be wrong. Is that the private sports bet sports book?
Yes.
So when I say private,
it's not a private sports book. It's a private casino. So, it's a members only. Technically, if you're staying at the Greenbrier, you have access.
Okay. All right. So.
You have to be a hotel resident there.
It's an interesting situation.
It works for them.
Hey, they're doing well. Good for them.
In Colorado, DraftKings and theScore have received approval for online sports betting in the state. The Colorado will be launching around May 1st, I think. They've already gotten 13 license issues overall, and they can issue up to a total of 60 licenses.
Wow.
For online and retail. DraftKings already is in place with Twin River on one of their properties. FanDuel has one of the other ones. Twin River is holding on to their third one. theScore has gotten a temporary license as a major vendor, and they are partnered with Jacobs Entertainment, which is going to be the Lodge and the Gilpin Casinos in Black Hawk, Colorado. So we had a lot of movement this past week. Oh, and last but not least, New Hampshire, which, thanks to Governor Sununu, is always on Twitter about their sports betting.
Okay.
15 towns are going to be voting on whether retail sports betting operations are going to be able to launch in their communities.
Okay, interesting. Big news out of New Hampshire. And the Turnpike Sports Book Report was brought to you by BorgataSports.com. Your favorite casino is now your favorite sports book, available anywhere in New Jersey. BorgataSports.com. Sign up at BorgataSports.com using our promo code PIKE, that's P-I-K-E, and you get a risk-free bet up to $300 and 20 bonus dollars at BorgataCasino.com. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
And once again, special thank you to Johnny Aitken and everyone over at PointsBet.
Absolutely.
For coming on and doing the interview with us. That'll be it for the show today.
Yeah. Have a great time. Win some money on some of the sports books Doug was talking about in the book report. So it looks like you have a lot of options to choose from. We'll see you next time on the Turnpike.